Hi everyone, good afternoon. My name is Ian. I'm the director of Confucius Institute at Ulster University. Just before I start my presentation, I would like to give you a short brief of what we do and our aim and objectives for our Confucius Institute. As you can see, you know, the Chinese people is very superstitious as well. We have similar culture on this part. And when we heard Chinese Vice Premier, Madam Liu Yandong, welcome to launch our Confucius Institute, we were so excited. Then when we saw the date, and I've been told by a few senior colleagues, which is no, we will get bad luck. Because that is on the 13th of April, which is a Friday. And in the China, we have to respect for both people who are important, the ministers from China and the ministers from Northern Ireland. And a total number is 13. So we have to put these 13 people on the first row. So that is a bit challenge for us, you know. So, well, from here side, we got all the bad lucks, you know. So, but, well, on the other hand, we get a great support from Northern Ireland executive and also from the Chinese government from a funding perspective. So we launched on the 13th of April, 2012, with one staff from China. And by the end of that year, we got another two colleagues from China. So we work with 109 students, which is include the primary school students, which is Melbourne Primary School. And then by 2013, and we got 10 staffs, and we work with just around 1,000 students in 2013. And last year, October, and we got 39 staffs, and we have 8 Confucius classroom hubs. We work with 123 schools in Northern Ireland. And half of them, they are primary schools, but we'll say 45% they are the post-primary schools. But we also work with college, which such as Southwest College, is one of our Confucius classroom hub, and plus the university. Although it's sadly to hear the School of Modern Language gone, but I believe the another faculty after the restructure of under the new leadership, we will have more Chinese as associate minor degree. So our aim is provide opportunity for every kids, for everybody in Northern Ireland who want to learn Chinese, who want to know more about China. That's us. And this year, October, we will have 52 staffs. All their salaries and the living allowances will be paid by the Chinese government. That is £40,000 per year, and which is over £2 million investment. And this is 15 years of commitment. And we are going to open another Confucius Classroom Hub application either by the end of this year or the beginning of the next year. So there'll be more schools and in different area, especially this time we will focus on the schools, we will focus on the students who from disadvantaged area. We will hope we set up the teacher in those area and to help those kids, to help those community. Chinese people is very hierarchy. And the company, especially like I was born in Changchun, which the name is we want forever springtime. But again, and as you said, as 9 months, it's quite cold, you know. So, but I moved to Shenzhen when my dad got a new post in China Resource Enterprise. So, but you know, that company is quite a big company. In China, it's a state-owned company. And for the most, as you know, before China opened policy, most company, I would say 90% of the company in China, they are state-owned company. And my parents' generation, they are the first people who experienced the change and actually and the open policy by former Prime Minister Deng Xiaoping is bringing those, a different career and it's a special new challenge career for them, and those people they are have a special experience. For and also those people, as you can see, most companies, no matter you work with a state-owned company or most who have quite a good reputation company, and the owner, they all are around, I would say, similar to my parents' generation. So for those people, they will think, you know, the first thing come to their mind is there are those people that are very, very loyalty. It's because the culture of the China, what they have experienced, like Cultural Revolution and whatever, you know, in their grow up time. So for those people, and if they are not, if the two countries or the two province, they don't have a good relationship, and they will judge you, and you are not their friends. As no matter what, how hard you work, you know, you are not their friends. As I heard the conversation, and just during the break time, gave example, like my grandfather is a businessman, but he will never ever work with Japanese people, because his father was killed by the Japanese armies when they took over our land. And surely things already passed, but in their mind, it's no matter how good of this business will be, how much money you will bring to us, and I'm not work with you. So for some people, in my parents' generation, yes, they have very firm opinions. But you know, with the new population, with the new new leaders, I would say, especially probably the leadership has got younger and younger, especially those kids who grew up in a very fortunate family. In China, we call 富二代 or 官二代. They started establish their own companies, and most of them, they graduate from the Western country, from somewhere outside of China. So for those kinds of young leaders, you know, who are around 40 years old, between 30 to 40, they have very a good, very open mind, you know. And also in this respect, I think now that Irish companies, you have very strong advantage, because you actually share the same land with the south part, you know. But most people will say I'm wrong, and you are the same, you know, people will say in here probably, you say you are Irish rather than you are British. But I think just use both sides, you know, so you can be a British, but you also share the same land in Ireland. You know, people in China, they all like everything Irish culture, like the river dance, and go through 55 major cities in China. And even in my hometown, you know, in my university age, and the pub we always go is Irish pub, who owned by an Irish man, you know, he always play with his friends every Thursday night, you know, so which is really good, you know. So Irish culture and Irish people, and we always feel it's very interesting and very very friendly, very kind. So if you feel, you know, probably it also depends on which province people you're going to meet. If they are from the south part of China, especially in Shenzhen, you know, I grew up, although I was born in Changchun, but I grew up in Shenzhen, and they just had a new museum. I don't know whether you've been there as well. They talk about the wars between the 19th century and how British took our land, our things, you know. So when you know the company based in that part, he will always say, oh, we are in Ireland, you know, or I'm the Irish people or something, you know. So if you don't mind, if you have strong opinion on your nationality, then just forget what I say. And so for the most company, especially for the state-owned company, and for the two countries who have a very good relationship, that definitely will help your business. And also those good news, you know, that definitely will help you start the conversation. Because I think since the Duke of Cambridge get married or get the baby or get their baby girl, you know, it's big news in China, you know. That's totally different culture. We don't have a real family. So that's a good way to start a conversation. But that is also a good thing. More senior people from our country and the UK frequently visit each other. That's different, more good policies. So especially, you know, last year, Madam Liu Yandong, they came over to China. She came over to UK, and she normally visits UK once a year, which is a great support. And last year also a good year for us as well, because we received two Excellence Individual Awards, which is one for the Minister Johnson Bell as his capacity as the deputy chairperson of our Confucius Institute at Ulster University, but also our vice chancellor received the new Excellence Award for our Confucius Classroom Program. And the most important visit will be, you know, the vice premier advanced visit, and also the, as you can see, we call President Xi. We gave his a nickname like Xi Dada, like Uncle Xi, you know, because he's trying to be, he has a, we believe, you know, we are really respect to our politicians. You never see any jokes about the senior politicians in mainland China, and we don't like those jokes. Well, in here it's okay, I like the joke cartoons, politician cartoons, but I don't like people joke about our politicians in China, especially those leaders, you know, political leaders, and we show them a great respect. And even for the Chinese company, if you first time met them, if you don't know them, and if you make some political, if you make some jokes about our political leader, and they will close the door forever. So. And but those is a very good thing, as I said, you know, especially more and more banks in China, they interested in the UK market. And we believe, and the people, that's the Chinese business, how they set up the money, they will use their, they will use the Chinese banks. When the Chinese bank moving, they will go, well, they will follow them, you know, most companies. And if they say, for example, the Bank of China, and also the China industrial or commercial bank, they have a branch in Manchester, or they have a branch in Edinburgh, like Bank of China have a branch in Edinburgh, and those places will be easy to attract business. And also, when you start the business in China, when you try to do business in China, and they will always ask you about what, you know, connections with China your company have, or your province have, or your, you know, your leader have, your country have, and that those connections is extremely important. So. And also I would like to mention about Northern Ireland and the China relations. So I think after Madam Liu Yandong's visit, that make a huge change, especially our first minister, deputy first minister, visit China twice. Is that right? Twice, and they plan to visit again. The new leaders plan to visit China again this year. And also, there's another good news, as Madam Wang Ling, who is the Deputy Director of People's Congress, which is similar to the Assembly, Northern Ireland Assembly level, and but she is more powerful, she is equivalent to the Vice Governor, so she took her team, come over, and they signed a memorandum of understanding between Hubei Province and Northern Ireland on cooperation on all different ways. That means they will build the platform for the business in Northern Ireland, but also build a platform for the business in China to do the trading with here as well. And especially last year, June, and Minister Wang Yi, who came over, launched the Chinese Consulate General Office in Belfast. That's a great thing for us. I feel I have home, you know, here. So, but also don't forget, if you're going to Hubei, you have home as well, because the British Consulate General Office was launched last year, January. So set up a consulate in both province that was under the country agreement, which is between the UK and China. So there's a special tied up between the how to say, Northern Ireland and China, especially on Hubei province. So that's why, you know, you can see once we lead any, you know, visit, especially on that and educational visit, Hubei is our main partnership. We have 39 teachers, and 26 of them is from Hubei Normal University, who are the specialist university training the teachers. So we have a special connection. But also, please do, I think that you will get a great help and support once you go to the trade missions. As I said, Chinese people, we are really hierarchy. And if we see the support from the government level, because there's only the trade missions and also CBBC events. They can set up people to arrange to that position. They will make things much easier, much smoother, much quicker, and even more protect for the local business in Northern Ireland. So. And if you're going to China, because I know normal routing will be from here to Beijing or from here to Shanghai, but in China, the transportation is very, well established. You know, if you go from Beijing to Shanghai, or from Beijing to Shenyang, which is our another partner province, Liaoning province, I do suggest if you travel around the summertime, would be better by train, by speedy train, rather than by flight, because in Beijing, the weather can be, you know, the flights has been always delayed, you know, so the trains will be only take around 3 hours. That's the bullet train or dongche, we call in China, which is pretty fast. So it's much easier and convenient, especially they have a few new stations has been built in Beijing. So if you're going to Shenyang or go anywhere, like even go Hubei from Beijing, it's only about 4.5 hours. So by the time you're going to the airport, the flight has been delayed, they have a long queue to check in, go to the security. And I think the trains may be a nice, relaxed way. And besides, you can see more countryside. And I have guaranteed you most of the, I won't say that, but where's the wood? I won't touch the wood. Every service is very safe, you know, because the Chinese transportation is very good, you know. So so I would strongly recommend it, especially during the summertime, because the weather is hardly to control. They have lots of heavy rain and lightning, you know, those things will cause the flight to be delayed. So, and also we are so proud of our food, as you can see the map. And they call it the Town of China. It's a very famous program. And they will introduce different food from different province. And, oh, sorry. Did I do something wrong? Yeah. So I think that's another good conversation as well. When I first time came here and I saw the Irish stew, because I'm from northeast of China, we have a very similar dishes. It's really make me homesick, you know. But I think there's this nice connection as well, you know. People from China and they love, we have different flavor of the food. For example, from south part of China, the food is always sweet and probably sweet and sour. And for the north part of China is always salty and strong flavored. And for the eastern part, this may be like they like barbecue, so they're good on the barbecues. And from Chongqing or Sichuan, different province, the food is really, really spicy. But, you know, I have been experienced when I accompany the companies of the people, colleagues going to China, they always worried, you know, people eat something weird, you know. Even myself, I'm from north part of China. When I go into the south part of China, I will ask, what is this, you know? And I saw very lovely dishes. Then I don't know, I didn't ask, but it tastes like a chicken, but it's not. So I asked, it tell me the snake. So it's make me jump to the bathroom, you know. So it's okay, just if you don't know what it's, ask, you know, most, like a company who have experience work with overseas colleagues, they won't put you in that situation. But I know some colleagues in here, they don't like see, when we serve a fish, we like have the fish head and the fish tail. Although I don't like the fish eye, look at me, you know. But they still serve in that way. And if they serve you, you know, the head toward you, it's actually to show their hospitality, or the tail to you, then you have to make a toast or something. That's actually a good thing. But if you don't want to eat it, or if you're allergic to anything, and if you're not sure about anything, just be honest, just ask, and they won't force you to eat it. You know, so they won't force you. And even myself, I'm a Chinese. If I don't know what I'm going to eat, and I won't eat it. So, and also, but I think, you know, Chinese people like show their hospitality. When you're on a business dinner or business lunch, especially the people, they like pick up things for you by public. We have say, we everybody use chopsticks, but we have a public chopsticks. We say everybody use it, you know, so, just for pick up the food from the plate. So they will use that, the chopstick to pick up the food for you to show the hospitality, you know. But when you see the menu, you just ask what it is, and if you don't like it, you just say, "Oh, I'm not eat it or something." But it's okay if you reject it at the beginning, rather than people pick up the food, want to give to you, and then you said, "I'm not eat it." That can be embarrassing. People will see their loose face. But if at the beginning you say you're allergic with the shellfish, you're allergic with peanuts, and I think that's okay, and you are vegetarian, and you don't eat white meat, red meat or something, is absolutely fine. And also, people in China, we love to talk about our food, you know, what you eat, especially in Beijing. They always say, "Ni chi le ma?" Have you eaten anything to start of the conversation, like people started conversation about the weather in here, you know, so. Just people from different province, and they have different hobbies. But for the food, and you can experience all sort of different food. But I think it would be nice if you could, before you go, and do some little bit of research, and to see what is the local food in those province or in the city you visit. And I believe that will be bring more closer connections between you and your host. Because they 100%, they 1,000% will serve you with their local famous dishes. So if you do some little bit of research, and even use the Google Pictures, you will see what dishes looks like. Then say thank you, and the people will be appreciated. So I think this will be a nice thing, you know, to start in that conversation for the lunch or for the dinner. So we also have the Chinese festivals, which is like a Chinese traditional New Year, will be start in the lunar calendar. And so it's quite like Easter here. And every year, the Chinese traditional New Year time is different, you know. So so be aware, you know, always say do not contact your company or do not make a visit during this public holiday period. Or do not expect everybody to get back to you if anything not urgent. And for the communications, so, but it would be nice, you know, most of people in China, we use a WeChat. It's another version, another APP similar to WhatsApp in here. I think, you know, would be very thoughtful, you know, if your Chinese partners, they use the WeChat and you WeChat, and in those most important holidays, even send them a picture or send them a message. That will be bring the close of the relationship as well. So, for those business meetings, especially the meeting with the big companies, as I mentioned, then they will normally take you to a conference room or meeting room. So the table can be round or can be square, you know, and in some meetings, you know, there will be to be seated on the both sides. So when you walk in, when you see, normally they will put your names on the table, so you will realize where you are going to sit, you know. So if your name is not on the table, I think maybe it's just better ask to say whether it's a seat free or they have another arrangement. And when people walk in, you know, most people get confused because, for example, I take a group of delegation and the Chinese delegation there, and they always confused who is the most important person. And if you have a meeting with the governments, or if you have a meeting with the the state-owned company, those important person will never ever come in to meet you in the front. They will always come in when you're seated. So the person who come to you first from the Chinese side is either the person who look after this visit, or the person who are the interpreter. So from another side, or the colleagues from another side, he or she will be never the important person. The person who come to you first is never the important person. What I mean is that when you're doing business with the big companies, but for the private company, for the small company, that will be totally different, you know. And the owners or the director, generals of the company, they want to show their hospitality, they will always meet and greet from the very beginning. And when you walk into the meeting rooms, you know, and I it would be better to start to exchange the business card immediately. And I have a personal habit. I like put my business card on the table by a certain order, so I know who I'm talking to, you know. And also, at the beginning of the meeting, it's always an introduction from both sides. Who are they from Chinese side? What's their responsibility? And my another habit is always like make a little bit notes on the card. It's okay when they see it. It's okay. Or you put card on a certain order, you make a notes behind, you know. So you just draw a little map. Then you know who, you will know who will be the person to follow up. But after that meeting, if during the meeting, if they not say who is the key person to contact from the other side, so don't be afraid to ask, you know. And I feel sometimes it's quite hard, you know, if you don't have your own, if you can't speak Chinese, if you don't understand Chinese, or if you don't have an interpreter on your side. So that can be, sometimes it can be confusion. So for the interpreters, so I hope, you know, so if the company, the partner in China, they can speak English, but that person is very, very senior, or the owner, or it's fine. But if that person is only the one of the staff or one of the department, and I would strongly suggest, you know, you bring, bring somebody you know from, bring somebody as an interpreter you can trust, either from Northern Ireland, or maybe you could contact CBBC. I believe they could provide a service. Oh, yes, yes, yes. So at least, you know, as I said, those person is a very valuable source, valuable resources for you. They can tell you the truth, you know. As I said, you know, people, have a different meanings, you know. Just purely translation, yes, it means 是的. But in different city, we use different word. I feel we had an education program with Henan province, which is one of the interesting province. And I realized, you know, after I spoke with my dad, but before I spoke with him, I don't know. When I had a conversation, the leader is always very positive, and he always say, "Zhong zhong 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 zhong." That means yes, 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 yes. So speak quite quickly, and it's very positive, so I got happy, but nothing has been move on. So I spoke with my dad. My dad said, no, when you heard people from Henan to say zhong 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 more than three times, so very quickly, that means no, 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 no. So, but if their firm decision will say zhong zhong, that means yes, I will going to do it. So if you have an interpreter from your side, and they will tell you all those truths, you know, because after the Chinese people is very polite, after the meeting, you think you got most business done, and you are so positive, but actually they may not that interested. So only your interpreter, only your people from your side, they can tell you the truth, you know, and by doing this. So, and also when you meet the interpreter or you get the interpreter from other services, please make sure you met them before, you know, and brief your company's information, and let them know what you are doing and what you want. I think that will be help during the interpreting, during the meeting, and especially for the technical firms and those things, that will be very helpful, because the interpreter, they may only good on English and Chinese translation. They may not have any knowledge about your company, about the products you sell. I think it's better, you know, you give them like information pipe, let them study before going to the meeting. That will be make a more valuable for your company. And also during the interpretations and translations, please do speak, break down sentence by sentences rather than a whole long paragraphs. And they may not have remembered the full thing. They may miss a very important points you made. So have a word with meet the interpreter in person to find out the way, you know, you work with each other, and I think that will be definitely beneficial to the business meeting you are going to have with the Chinese side. And regarding with the business lunch or business dinner, and most hosts, you know, will be in the private room, unless there's special events or some will be like a big open room like this. If in the private room, in the meeting table, you will always find the seat, especially the host seat, has already been set up, you know, because the Chinese people were superstitious. We so think feng shui is important. So who is the main host? That position is always, when you walk in, you know, it's always face, well, the background is face to the east, but sometimes the hotel structure can be different. So they put something special on in the glass. So you will see that is the host. But I think the better you just wait and for them to take you to your own seat, rather than you kind of, you don't know where you're seated in. I think the Chinese host is always good on this. You know, they take you to the private hotel restaurant room and they will tell you which seat you can sit, you know, for the dinner. And also for the drinking toast, and normally the main host will make a toast. And to be respectful, and I would strongly recommend that the people from this side will be responsive toast. And that's in different province. Business have different habits. For example, three of us, for example, from my park, and then seven from Kofco in China. After the main people who doing a toast, the rest six from Chinese side, they may toast you individually. And every of them, they will come to you. So in this time, I think our strategy is always sacrifice one person who can drink more, then keep the rest who are the decision maker have a clearly head, you know? So because all, if you can't drink, and be honest at the beginning, don't drink two glasses and say you can drink anymore. And then people will think, oh, you are not honest with me. And most of the people, especially business people, they feel, you know, if you drink some wines, and you'll be more honest, you know, so, and more relaxed, and, excuse me. And the last thing, but not least, don't forget, the alcohol, the wines in China is not made by fruit, it's made by rice. And especially the most famous one is called Moutai, and it's over 50% of alcoholic. So be aware what you drink, and also, you know, just if you have a business negotiation, have you say the person who are take the lead, and they just maybe better just take the water or another thing at the beginning. Say, are you allergic with alcohol or something? Better not to just you know, take a few drinks, then stop, then reject everything. Then people won't be happy on that. So, and also. Most of my colleagues, they will say, when I bring them to a private dinner, they will feel, oh, the meeting, it's kind of like follow schedule. After the meeting, then going to the, everybody get onto the car and go to the restaurant. And after a few toasts, you didn't feel, you just feel, oh, the conversation should be start, then suddenly everything's over. So they feel the dinner or lunch start very quick and finish by quick. And that is normally, you know, the people doing business. But please do follow up. It's not that mean we are not interested to doing business with you, but please do follow up, you know, to say, okay, we just had a very good conversation on A, B, C, D, E, you know, then, you know, maybe we can discuss this further. And most of business, you know, I have experience, you know, I think the challenge for me is, this seems kind of like, because we're doing business, like we have to do with friends, or we have to see. The first time we're meeting, although it's a very long journey for you to travel to China to introduce your company, but do not expect that business can be done just for your first visit. And do not expect the business can be done just for three visits or something, you know, because people in China, since we opened the market for similar products from different country, maybe to work to that company, you know, maybe they receive the similar requests, similar products information every day. So you think you are the best. I believe you are the best. But you know, for them, they have you know, they have to get everything together. So I think, you know, every time when you're going to meet the Chinese partner, well prepared, you know, and in a very short meeting time, be pointed out what is your strong strongest side about your products? What is why your products more competitive with others? You know, let them believe that. And also, I think it's very important to look at their website to see what is their goal. Most companies, they have various plans. You probably heard last year, even the foreigners make a song about the China 5 years plan. You know, like most companies, they have 5 year plan as well. So find out their 5 year plan, and most companies, they have their annual report, and they will publish those annual reports and to find the same goal. And like Confucius, we are Confucius Institute, to say people from far away, we have the same goal, and we work together, we are happy. So find out if you are not have the same goal, and it's very hard to find the commons and to work together. So that's the business dinner. And what not to give for the business gifts, you know. I would say people from different province, they will give you a different answer, you know. But most of common things we are not really gave is the things we use in the funeral, the things we believe will bring the bad luck, you know. Even for the flower shop, you know, you think it's nice to bring a bunch of flower to your friends, but then you have a mistake, put the second one there, you know. So because those most of the things, something we use in the funeral, we never bring our bad luck or something we never give to the friends. Well, if you don't want to be a friend with them, okay, you know, that's a good reason to show, you know, you don't want to be friends with them, otherwise it's not. I know there's a beautiful candle holders in the UK market, you know, it's really lovely, like a Victoria style step, you know, so it's beautiful candle holders. And some people think it'd be nice to bring candle as well, and with the candle holder, but I think that won't be a good idea, you know. So just a candle holder will be okay, but not the candle. And also, that's the flower we don't like, you know, because this, the sadness will bring to us when we're using the funeral, you know. And also a clock. Zhong, song zhong, is mean, you know, it's another mean of death. So we never give a clock. I saw a lovely crystal pin set, you know, the word on the table set, you can put a table on the table, and the one side you put the pen, another set a beautiful clock. And I don't want to say that in front of my colleague, but I do find I think a few years ago, this was our university corporation gifts, you know, so do not ever bring those things to the Chinese colleagues, you know, then that's a not a good gifts. And umbrella in most, like in Hubei or people, you know, different province people, they believe umbrella is a san. It means san. It means you want to depart, you want away from each other. So that's a not good gift. Although you have very good branding in here, like Burberry, they have a beautiful umbrella and they're quite popular in China. But people normally buy themselves those things rather than give each other umbrella. And I just think of, tomorrow we talk about umbrella, and I heard that my colleague said, you never open the umbrella in here, is that right? Inside of your house, and that will be bring the bad things to the home as well. So we have something similar in here. And also there's a few things like a scissor, like a cut down your relationships. So you never bring the scissor or anything, you know, of the shape or everything looks like that. And also, knife and a sword and anything very sharp, you know. And also, what I mean fun is, I'm sorry, can I go back to that? Yeah. Thank you. This is very popular, especially when you go to somewhere very hot, like in south of China, but in most province, and they don't like you give this those things as well. Again, similar to umbrella, that means shan, their Chinese name, this means san, so, you know, san. So that means you don't want to be together as well. So just some pronunciations have bad meanings. People are very superstitious, so they don't like those kinds of gifts. And most seriously, I know we have lots of students and who are, once they graduate, they went to China. And every time when I have a Chinese visitor, when they come around, especially on the St. Patrick holidays, and that's always make them have a special, a time for them to be in Northern Ireland, you know. And I know this is actually the green hat for the St. Patrick Day is actually the traditions come from Americans, is that right? Yeah. But I saw lots of people, the students wear a green hat in here as well. But in China, if a man wear a green hat, that can be a very, very serious problem. That means their wife has been cheated, them has been a, his wife has a boyfriend or something, you know. So never ever give a hat to the people in, well, to, especially to the man in China, especially on the green color. So we have a graduate went to Chinese university to work, and on the St. Patrick Day, I know even 1 year, the whole Great Wall has been light up green, so he wear a green hat to the university. So it's make a lot of, how to say, quite a serious joke for the Chinese students for that, you know. So I will say, let's see, what you want to give, you know, even myself, I think that's quite a challenge for me. Something has to be local and has to be light so you can easy to carry them. But please do not buy something made in China and bring this back this far away, give to the you know, your delegations in China. And the cooperation gifts will be nice. And in China, people will present the gift in a beautiful gift box. If you don't have a gift box, I think if something is not a border, or maybe you could bring the wrap paper with you, then you wrap it when you give to them. You know, that's, it's just kind of like show how you take seriously about this relationship. And also, regarding with the gifts, you know, as I always like to buy the whiskey as well, especially the blue label one. You can put the person's name and their companies, you know, on the label. You give them as a with gifts. But I always find, you know, so those important gifts, maybe if you, every time you give them those, I don't think they would be appreciated. They know this is something special from Ireland. But I think even in the Chinese New Year time, if this business partner is really good for you, and it's nice even in the Chinese New Year time, you post them a Chinese design postcard, you know, that will be thoughtful. Or even e-card, you know, email them a card, you know, to I think this will be nice as well. But to bring your relationship even more closer with them, because for example, you work with a Chinese company and you know him very well, and he is a very, very senior position, and you, once you meet them more, you will get to know their families. And I think it's nice, you know, next time if you're struggling with the gifts and you know he has a son and a daughter who are around 11 years old or something, buy something local, you know, from here. Like I know lots of people ask me to buy the Scottish coat, you know, for their children. I think this is something nice, you know, and they will be surprised with those gifts. And you'll bring more closer relationship with them, you know. But that's what I mean. When you become a friend with them, then you can do that. Not really for everybody you met, you know, and things like that. So when you on the, how to say, start a conversation, not in the meeting, we say around the lunch or around dinner or around another, like events, you know, I won't say you don't talk about something not to talk. Once we become friends, you can ask me everything, but it also depends on where you ask me, whether in a formal meeting, just after formal meeting, everybody around me, or just we are friends and we just have a tea or coffee, you know, once we meet to have a relaxed time, you know, it's all bring those things, you know, and the people will be honest. I will be honest with my friends, you know, if they ask me the right question, they ask me any question in the right time, you know, so which is not in the formal meeting or not in around, in front of all the business, another Chinese business or something, you know, so. But it's, if you know this person the first time you meet them and then you want to, you know, you want to bring the close relationship, I think, as I mentioned, it's nice, you know, you do a little bit of research before you're going to China and going to see what is the famous sightseeings, for example, like tourist attractions in those places, and what is a local famous food. And those are always, you know, very nice topic to start with. But also, you know, talk about, we all like talk about our own families in China, like people here. We all like talk about the weather as well, especially the weather wasn't good in China. And we all like to talk about the histories of China. So that's all the, I would say, safe topics, you know. But there's a few topics is very sensitive. And it's also depend on how you're going to ask, you know, for people. I know there's maybe I shouldn't say that, but there is a Free Tibet Association, and for the people have always have a strong opinion on those things, you know. I think once you start reach to some sensitive topic, and if the Chinese people know you have a strong opinion on those things who are totally opposite to them, and you may just kill your business opportunity in China. So for those sensitive topics, if you not know the Chinese side very well, I think it maybe it's better not to ask, you know, and once you get to know the Chinese side, if they are, and it depends on our personality as well. So maybe, well, people have a different opinion on different things, you know, so if you're not, at least quite like here, if you don't know each other and then you start with very topic, people can take it in different way, you know. If I don't know you and you said, oh, Tibet should be independent, then I think that's bring debates before we talk about everything else, you know. So people are very loyalty in China. We are very loyalty to our country, especially when the first time when they see the overseas person and they don't know you, actually, they don't know your company, then you start those sensitive topics will be, that's not, we will see not respect, rather than, you know, we understand people have different opinion, but we will see, take it as a respect way rather than another culture way or something. So I believe that the language, you know, the link of the language ability in communication in Chinese and the understanding of the Chinese culture is still the barriers for the company, especially in Northern Ireland, to enter the Chinese market. And also, that will be the disadvantage for the business in here, you know, to because if your Chinese side, only like one person in the whole office and who are not in the senior level can understand the can understand English. So every time your email comes to them, be honest, they have to translate it to Chinese, and they have to report to the line manager, and their line manager have to report it to their line manager. So you don't know how much hustle will go through to the decision maker, you know. So, but if you could, I will say, you know, I will suggest that the people have, you will have your information pack about your company, and I think better to have a brochure if you really take a Chinese marketing seriously, get something in Chinese, then you will know if they ask something, very basic information you can give to them. Oh, we have more and more Chinese, how to say, graduates from both universities, but we also have a lot of local students study Chinese, especially in our university as well. I think those are the people, you know, maybe there's a potential job opportunity for them as well. So I think get somebody from your side and who can, if something you can do, how to call it, less hustle for the Chinese colleagues, the business will be more smooth, you know, because besides your business or your products, the people in China, they may have another jobs, you know. So if every time they have to translate your products and report all those things, and they may just even not those things not reach to decision maker, and those people in the in those level, they will just kill the opportunity. So, and also most, I would say, another challenge is especially on the food products. You know, the Chinese regulation has been changed, obviously, every year. So please do do a lot of research yourself. Most information is in the, you know, in the government, Chinese government website. But also, I do get a newsletter from CBBC and from Invest Northern Ireland. They are very, very helpful. You know, I think you should do some a little bit of research and keep up-to-date information rather than think about, you know, if you not have up-to-date information, that will be a big barriers for the company to enter into the Chinese market, especially like food-related products, because the rules, the policies nearly change every year. So, and also personal connections is very important in China. We call guanxi, you know, who you know. It's quite similar to the West business model, who you know and how to do the business, you know. And the Chinese networking, it can be, you know, how to say, not only through the family connections, but through the colleagues or through the relationships, through the, the classmates, you know, especially people in my parents' generation, they think a classmates would be more powerful. They are in different powerful situations. So personal connections is really important, but it's also, once you find that key person, and then I believe that that's the best opportunity to open that market for you. So. And also, as I mentioned, the people, especially in the big company or state-owned company, and if they not trust you, or if they not believe this is a business benefit to both sides, and they may not go ahead. And also for the, I think, you know, for doing, that's another challenge is people may not understand the business practice. Chinese, again, as I said, it's very hierarchy. So you have to understand how the business can be done. You know, who is in charge of who, how they're going to make the decision in the Chinese company. And otherwise, you may always punch to the wrong person. And sometimes those person in different position, they will see, you know, I won't touch that area because that I will be step on another colleague's business, you know, so you, that's mean your business will never move on forward. So and at last, because we're from Confucius, we promote Chinese language. So I would like to share a few sentences. And for you to go to China, it's quite like when you're going to France, you have to, although my French is really bad, but I have to show, at least I use one word, greeting them to show, you know, I'm trying to make the effort. So. The first sentence is we say, "Ni hao," it means we're greeting people. How are you? It's normally, you know, when people walk in and you meet them, you will say shake hand very short and firmly. You say, "Hey, ni hao, ni hao." So that means how are you? And that's very normal when you most popular greeting when you meet the business colleagues from the Chinese side. So ni hao, would you mind repeat with me?
Ni hao.
Very good. Ni hao.
Ni hao.
Very good. And then the very easy way we say, xie xie. You will use it all the time. Xie xie. Well, normally the third one, we always, in China, we always say bye bye or goodbye, you know, but we do have sentences to say goodbye in Chinese. It's 再见. 再见. And the fourth one is introduce yourself. I am. We always say 我是. My name is Yan Liu. 我是 Liu Yan. 我是. Yeah. So you can put your name behind 我是, so they will know who you are. And the last one, I would say the most important one. And when you drink a toast, and it's quite like a cheers in here, but it's also slang chai in Irish. And we in China we say 干杯. 干杯. 干杯.
干杯.
In Chinese, just from the pure word meaning, it means bottle up. But please do not bottle up. When your host raises the first toast, if he bottle up, you have to bottle up. If he is not bottle up, you don't need bottle up. So if he bottle up, you have to bottle up. Then when you respond to a toast, and you have to bottle up, then he will bottle up. So that is we show the respect, you know. So just watch how much he or she drinks before you finish your wine or finish your drinks. So that's me. Thank you very much. Thank you.